so many sleeping areas.
We have some open seating here as well. If anyone wants to get very intimate, we can.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here with us today. I'm sorry for my voice, I'm just recovering from laryngitis. I try to speak as loud as possible. Happy Nowruz, happy Easter to you all. And today, candidates who are here today are Mr. Rubin, Mr. Raskin, Mrs. Mathews, and Mr. Trone, and we are happy to have you there. You will have time to actually to introduce yourself in details in about 90 seconds. But before doing so, I would just like to give a brief description of who we are as Iranian-Americans, in case some of you may not have the opportunity to know us before, you know, in details. We are an immigrant community that came to the United States. Majority of us came in 1970s, during 1970s. And we are now in our third generation immigrants, being American, Iranian Americans. We keep a very close tie to the people of Iran. And we've been ranking statistically very high achievers within the, you know, more than 50% percentile of U.S. population. So we've been good in academia and business. Also, we have been very successful in assimilating into the U.S. culture, while we also bring our own culture to U.S. Our country of origin, Iran, is a multicultural and very diverse country, which cannot be defined solely by religion. Its cultural ethnicities is amazing, and it's much more than the neighboring countries in the Middle East. We have probably about only 50 to 60% old Persians or Parsis, and the remaining 40% are composed of Baluchis, Kurds, Azerbaijanis, Georgians, Tajiks, Gilaks, Turkmens, to name a few, and each have their own dialect. And also we have Armenian and Assyrians who are Christians, and we have Jews and Baha'is. Now, let's talk a little bit about Nowruz. Nowruz is a celebration, is a traditional celebration that goes back more than 3,000 years. It actually precedes Zoroastrians. And its characteristics is similar to pagans, which have like respect to nature, love of nature, and basically respect to the environment and cleanliness and the environment and keeping the environment healthy, which has been in tuned into the fabric of the people in that area for centuries. Now, what do we look to our candidates? What are we looking in our candidates to do for us? We have been, recently, as you know, we've been subjected to a lot of negative rhetorics from the GOP candidates about Iran. We fear that these rhetorics may lead to discrimination against us. Hopefully, we don't want to be scapegoated for expedited political gains. And also, obviously, any population or community that is subjected to negativity and rhetorics, it would hamper their inspiration, and it would detrimental to their development. Having said that, I would now like to give the floor to our wonderful candidates to introduce themselves. I was told by Mr. Khan that you have 90 seconds to introduce yourself. And then afterwards we go through some questions. Please.
We can give you each 2 minutes.
Mr. Rubin.
Thank you. Hi everyone, good afternoon. My name is Joel Rubin, and I'm thrilled to be here with you. Grateful for you taking the time today to be with us to hear what we're running for and why we're running. And also, frankly, grateful that you're making your imprint on this race, coming out and meeting with candidates. It's very impactful and very important. I'm able to go into depth and detail a little later on about policy issues, but I want to share a story with you about why I'm so excited to be here with you. In 2007, I was a congressional staffer working in the Senate, and it was the middle of 2007, and I got a phone call from someone from New Jersey who was Iranian-American. And she called because at that time, going to what Houri was talking about, there were calls for military action against Iran. And she called, and she said, please don't let them start the war with Iran. And I say that because it impacted me. It became very clear there's much more going on than just politics on Iran and the Middle East that we're dealing with here. We're dealing with real people, a family, who have a deep concern about what's happening inside of Iran. And so from that moment, it became clear to me that as a Democrat working in the Senate, not only was I fighting to change the direction of our foreign policy, which is my background in foreign policy, national security, and trying to stop the war in Iraq, but I also tried to position my work to prevent another war of choice, and that would be the war with Iran. Many of you here in this audience have worked for years as activists or advocates or supporters of the advocacy organizations opposing war with Iran. I am very grateful to have had your support in this as a congressional staffer, and then later on, I helped to start an organization called J Street, which is the Middle East Peace pro-diplomacy organization from the Jewish community, where we helped to develop pro-diplomacy positions inside the Jewish community. I went from there to Plowshares Fund, which is a leading foundation that organized many of the activities supporting diplomacy with Iran to get a nuclear deal and really to stop war with Iran. After that work, I was then asked by Secretary Kerry to come work in the Obama administration, and I was the senior official handling the House of Representatives, the place where we all want to work, handling the House of Representatives for the State Department as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State. And we fought that fight, and we won, and we stopped the war with Iran. And so it's from that frame that I'm very grateful to be here, to be with you, to speak about why we all hope to be representing you in Congress this coming year. Thank you.
Good afternoon, and happy Nowruz, and happy Easter, and happy Passover upcoming. Houri, I've got to say, we have met, I think, 14 or 15 times for debates like this, forums. We've been in middle school gyms, we've been in basement of rec rooms, we've never quite been in a surrounding like this before. So I want to thank you for opening up your beautiful house. So my name is Jamie Raskin. I'm the state senator for Silver Spring and Tacoma Park, which is what I've done for 10 years, but I'm also a professor of constitutional law at American University, which is what I've done for 25 years. That's been my main career. I'm a law professor. I have with me today one of my beloved colleagues, Patti Day Alai, who's a close friend and advisor to me, and she's Iranian American. Also some of you may know Saru Shahabi, who's also a very close advisor and friend of mine, but he's in California, so he couldn't be here. So I was born here and I grew up here. I've lived most of my life here. My dad used to say everybody's got two impulses in life, and one is to fly like a bird and the other is to stand like a tree. And I've always been a tree person. I love it here, except for my time away at college and law school at Harvard. I've been here pretty much my entire life, and I brought my wife back here, and we've raised our three kids here. So I got into politics 10 years ago because George W. Bush was president, and it was a very despondent and bleak period for those of us who are true blue ardent Democrats like me. We had the Iraq war going, we had the Afghan war going, the economy was spiraling downward, and one day I looked in the newspaper and I saw that my state senator had introduced a pro-Iraq war resolution in the Maryland Senate. And my state senator had introduced a death penalty bill in the state senate. My state senator had introduced electricity deregulation that made everybody's bills go up 70 or 80% and been blockading marriage equality. And I said, you know what, I'm going to run for the state senate. And everybody told me two things. They said, one, it's crazy. You cannot beat a 32-year incumbent who's president pro tem of the senate. And two, even if you were by some miracle to win, you could never beat the conservative Democrats who run Annapolis and get done all the crazy stuff you're talking about doing. Is that really my knock?
That's your knock.
Okay. All right, I'll tell you the rest of the story when I come back.
And for clarification, if I knock twice, that means you have 15 to 20 seconds left. If I knock three times, that means you're really done. Okay. So you still have time. I think I'm going to sit on that side.
I'll save my 20 seconds. Thanks for explaining the knock-knock system.
How's it
going to
knock now?
Sure.
Corey, thank you.
Sure.
Corey, thank you so much to you and your husband for hosting us. And this is really a beautiful view. I wish you could all stand up here and see how great you look in this gorgeous dining room. My name is Kathleen Mathews, and I have many connections to the Iranian community. You talked about how integrated you are here in the D.C. area, and I see my good friend Miriam, who I've known for a long time. But as I go through our life, my husband and I have pharmacists, endodontists, lamp specialists, framers, all of whom are from the Iranian-American community. And like you, many of you, I came here in 1975, in the middle of the 70s, as an immigrant from California, which is where I grew up. I'm one of five children, went to Stanford University, and was very much involved in the politics against the Vietnam War, pro-environment, but also was inspired by Watergate to come to Washington as a journalist. And for 30 years, I worked at Channel 7, both behind the scenes as a young writer and producer, worked my way up to being a street reporter and then a news anchor. And then I had a wonderful opportunity to make a career shift 9 years ago when I went to work for Marriott International. And I know some of you have told me that some of your family members also work for Marriott, which gave me the opportunity to work for a big global company in 80 countries around the world and get global experience with our economy, but also issues such as terrorism, because during the time I was there, we had many instances where hotels were bombed by various terrorist groups. And that world life experience is really what has motivated me at this incredible period in our history to want to run for Congress, to represent this area, to be really the public servant for this area, but also to bring the global perspective I got working for a global company and the kind of solutions that we need to have to solve the real problems that we face in our country today and that the world faces today. And I think we're at an amazing inflection point. And Houri, you touched upon it. You know, we're at sort of a fork in the road, and we have a decision to make in 2016 as a country, whether we're going to move in the direction of our progressive values, our values of inclusion, our values of opportunity, or whether we're going to take the other fork, a fork that is about discrimination, scapegoating people. And I know that your community, like many communities, are so concerned by the rhetoric that they're hearing in this presidential debate, particularly with Donald Trump, but also the other candidates, talking about how we want to close our borders, close our country, keep people out of this country, a country that has been the beacon for waves of immigrants since our earliest days. And we can't let that happen. And that's why I'm running for Congress. I'm tired of the gridlock, I'm tired of the partisanship as a citizen. But I'm also afraid of the future if people with progressive values don't stand up and speak out about the choices that we need to make. And that's what I hope to bring to this race, and I look forward to the conversation about the specifics of how we do that and how we get it done. Thank you very much.
All
everybody, I'm David Trone, and first of all, thank you again. Beautiful, awesome house, great crowd. I live with my wife and four kids in Potomac, a couple miles down the street. We have a significant number of Persian contacts and friends in this area. I see a number of them here today. So we're really delighted to be able to have this opportunity to speak to you folks today. And the key thing I want to mention right off the bat is all of us together are equally repulsed. It's just what's happened in the Republican Party with Mr. Trump and the others in the party is just so un-American, so wrong, and let's just count on Americans' good sense. I think we can count on it that he will lose and lose big, and we'll have Hillary Clinton in the White House, and this divisiveness, this ugliness will be behind us because it's just horrible. It's not who America is. My background is I grew up on a farm north of here, north of the district. The farm failed. You've seen some of the commercials. My dad went bankrupt. I took over from my mom and the four younger kids as being in charge after the divorce and went back to the University of Pennsylvania Wharton School, took out a lot of student debt and got my MBA, met my wife there. She has an MBA, she's an engineer at the Wharton School, and then began to build a business. And that business today is Total Wine and More. We went from the business of bankruptcy from one small store. Now we have 21 stores, over 5,000 team members, and 21 states, 5,000 team members, and 150 stores. And the business will do over $2.5 billion this year. So it's a significant business. We're the largest retailer in America for wine, spirits, and beer. I'm the outsider in this race. I'm not part of the inner Washington establishment. I'm looking to shake things up, looking to bring change, looking to bring new ideas. That's what we do. And as a retailer, if you're not changing in business as an entrepreneur, if you're not bringing new ideas, and that's what Congress needs. The approval rating's 14% in Congress. It doesn't get much lower than that. And we need change. We need those new ideas. So I hope appreciate you stepping up and voting this year.
We have a statement from Will Juwando's campaign. Originally, Mr. Juwando RSVP'd to attend, and then subsequently withdrew his RSVP.
Hello, my name is Hamza. I am surrogate for Will Juwando. He gave me a statement to give to you today. He wants to thank everyone for being here, and thank you for inviting him. He indicated that he's not in attendance, as today is among the most holy days in my religion. I'm reading verbatim. And I am observing my faith with my family, Michelle, our girls, and extended family. I look forward to connecting with many of you in the coming weeks, and will make it a point to do so. On Friday, I was honored to join some of our neighbors at the Imam Center in Silver Spring, and we'll discuss the many difficult and serious issues facing our nation. This is a critical time for our country, but we are more politically divided than ever, and many Americans don't feel like their interests are being represented in Congress. Now, new perspectives and fresh voices are needed to move this country forward. My father came to this country from Nigeria fleeing violence, and I grew up here in Rubin County. When my parents separated, my mom worked hard to make ends meet, only to find out she was paid far less than her male counterparts. As a husband and father of three daughters, I know how equal pay for equal work is important for women and families. I was proud to work with President Obama in the White House to pass the Lilly Ledbetter Act, and I am committed to continuing that work to secure equal pay for all women. When I worked in Congress with Democratic leader Nancy Pelosi and on the Senate Education Committee, I was often the youngest and only person of color in the room, and when I stood up to speak about the importance of Head Start and Pell Grants for our children, people listened, and we expanded these programs. In February, my staff attended a community discussion on hate and violence at the Muslim Community Center, MCC, not far from where we are today. People like Donald Trump and Ted Cruz are tapping into a part of America that has always been part of our history. They are using fear, hate, racism, and xenophobia to push a very dangerous message and agenda forward.
We must do whatever we can to make sure neither Trump nor Cruz win in November. We must beat back such dangerous and, quite frankly, offensive language, and as your congressman, I am committed to fighting for you and standing up for all people in the face of extremism. I believe I am uniquely qualified because I have the experience of getting things done in Congress, and I understand the issues facing working families because I've lived them. Things will stay the same if we keep sending the same kinds of people with the same networks to Washington. We have an opportunity to right here in the 8th District, to send some of the fresh voice and fresh ideas to Congress. Last week, I was honored to receive the endorsement of Congressman John Lewis, an icon of civil rights movement. He and I agree that now more than ever, we need to send two progressive leaders to Congress who are ready on day one to make immediate impact.
Apparently, we have some extra seating where we would like you to come and join us up here if you'd like.
Oh, no seat. You can go around. Go right there and go around.
Each candidate will have around 3 to 4 minutes to answer each question. I think that would be around.
Okay. So we will start with our questions. Not yet. The questions are afterwards. So now, starting the questions, I will start from Mr. Rubin. Okay, and then
sure.
Next one from Mr. Trump coming back this way. Many people in Montgomery County rely on Metro. As you know, our red line Metro is in need of repair and maintenance. And our water pipes in Montgomery County is also in dire need of repair. As an appropriator of funds in the Congress, what would you do to have funds to improve this situation infrastructure in Maryland, considering the huge national deficit that we are running right now?
Thanks, Mark. So 3-4 minutes on each question?
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. So in case you didn't hear, the question is about transportation and what are we going to do as members of Congress to help transportation, infrastructure, and network. Transportation is a quality of life issue. I think all of us know that. It's an issue about how we get to work, how we move our kids to school, just how we get out in the evening. I've taken Metro to work for nearly 20 years. I've been in public service for nearly 20 years, working in the government, working on Capitol Hill, working in advocacy downtown. And the Metro has gotten worse and worse every year. I truly believe that our priorities are backwards in terms of how we budget money. And this goes to the question that Houri asked, which is, as an appropriator, how do you deal with this? I worked for two senators who were appropriators, Senator Tom Harkin and Senator Frank Lautenberg, and I handled appropriations accounts for them. Now, we're going to lose Senator Barbara Mikulski at the end of this year. She is one of the most powerful appropriators in Congress. That's going to be a major blow to Maryland and its ability to get funds moving towards the state and towards projects and key priorities. But it goes deeper than just purely appropriations bills and moving money through an earmark or a very designated area. It goes to the way that we do our overall thinking about the budget. The budget is, in many ways, the truest expression of the priorities of a government. And our government's priorities right now are that for every dollar, 2/3 of those dollars go to mandatory spending we cannot touch. Many very important things, nonetheless, things we cannot touch. Social Security, it goes to paying down the debt. It goes to essentially programs that are designated for that spending. 1/3 of the dollars, and this is where transportation fits, 1/3 are discretionary. Now, of those discretionary dollars, 60% go to national security programs. 40% go to domestic programs. Of the 40%, overall, it's about 90, 95 billion overall. It's about 7% of the full pie goes to transportation. And so we're talking very small amounts of money. Now, from where I sit, that's a major problem. When I was at Plowshares Fund, we estimated, as a nonprofit foundation focusing on nuclear weapons, trying to get a diplomatic deal with Iran, but also trying to change the way America's nuclear arsenal is organized, we estimated that $60 to $70 billion per year was being spent to maintain America's nuclear arsenal. And think about that. That's an arsenal that we're never going to use, God forbid. Certainly, it won't defeat terrorists sitting in Belgium. We're not going to drop a nuclear bomb on Belgium to defeat a terrorist network. So these are backwards weapons, and we're talking tens of billions of dollars, practically equivalent to what we spend on transportation right now in this country. So we need a member of Congress who understands these issues, who understands not just the big picture numbers, but actually what the numbers mean and how they impact our objectives. From a national security perspective, we are putting our money in the wrong pots. I know this because I was a senior national security official, and every single day my job was to communicate between the State Department and the House of Representatives, both Republicans and Democrats, to get things done. And I was in the classified briefings, and I was in the negotiations, and I was in the hearings and preparing Secretary Kerry and going and testifying myself. These are serious issues. We need serious people who have the experience on day one to get in there and make the arguments behind the scenes as well as in public. There are certain members of Congress that do this already. Jerry Connolly is one of them. Many may know him for his excellent work on Iran. There are members who bring in national security and foreign policy background, but not many. In fact, very few. And in this race, I'm the only candidate that has any foreign policy background as well. But if we're going to move money to transportation, we're going to have to make sure we find the savings from within the budget. We also, at a higher level, are going to have to deal with the Republican intransigence on the sequester. We're going to have to deal with the unfair balance right now we have on how we generate revenue for the government through our taxation policies. There are a lot of issues, but we're spending money in the wrong way on national security, and it's a major problem, and it depresses the district. I'll close with this. If we don't have a functioning transportation network, we can forget about having a 21st century economy. This district can be the backbone of a 21st century economy through biotech. We need to have an infrastructure that matches that. Thank you.
So I grew up on the metro. I don't know how many of you guys grew up here, but when I was a kid, they built it and it changed my life. It opened up the whole region to me. It opened up my ability to get to museums, to get to go see the government, to see my friends. I got to go to a dance. I met my first girlfriend through the metro. I love our metro system. And it's a scandal that it has been allowed to deteriorate the way that it has. And you know, it closed for the first time in its history for a day because of safety repairs last week. And Mr. Wiedefeld made the absolutely right decision because we cannot be putting the safety of the passengers at risk. My wife and I deliberately chose to live three blocks from the metro. My wife is the Deputy Secretary of the Treasury Department. She takes the metro to work a lot and comes back, but oftentimes she can't count on it. So we need a major investment in safety, which is ongoing now, and a major investment in reliability to attract people back. If I win this race, I will take the metro to work. I will just get on the Red Line, get off at Union Station, and I'll walk to my office. I think I'd be the only member of Congress who rides the metro to work. So the problem of the metro system is reflective of a larger systemic crisis that we've got in America today, which is an ailing infrastructure and a right-wing Tea Party philosophy that has organized economic and fiscal disengagement from the infrastructure of the country. The roads and the highways are suffering. The transit systems are suffering. The port systems. The water is poisoned in Flint, Michigan. And in other cities across the country, we are giving children poisoned lead water to drink in the wealthiest country on earth because we have disengaged from our own infrastructure. So I am calling for what I call a Green Deal for America. a massive reinvestment in the American infrastructure at every level in an environmentally positive and sustainable way. And we could start right here in the nation's capital and the surrounding areas with a massive infusion of money to the metro system and put it on stable, continuous funding from Maryland, Virginia, and DC to create an interstate compact so that all of us are putting in enough money to create the beautiful kind of metro system that it started off as. It was a victory of New Deal and great society thinking, that metro system. We've got to get back to that belief in public things and public institutions. Can I just finish my story?
You're fine.
Great, okay. So when I said I was going to run, and then, you know, everybody said, it's crazy, you can't beat a 32-year incumbent, and if you were to win, you could never get done the crazy things you're talking about doing, like abolishing the death penalty, like passing marriage equality, like restoring voting rights for the ex-felons, like banning military-style assault weapons, like passing tough environmental legislation to dramatically reduce Maryland's greenhouse gas emissions. And I said, okay, I'm definitely going to run. If it's impossible to do things, I'm going to run. And the newspaper had an article when I first got in it saying Raskin's chances of victory are considered impossible. And 9 months later, we got 67% of the vote, and another pundit said on the radio, Raskin's victory was inevitable. So it went from impossible to inevitable in a nine-month period. But it was never impossible, it was never inevitable. It was only possible through the democratic arts of education, organizing, and mobilizing for change. And when I announced that I was going to run, I laid out everything I wanted to do, and a woman came up to me after my speech. She said, Jamie, great speech, I love your speech, but take out all that stuff in there about gay marriage, because it's never going to happen, and it makes you sound like you're really extreme, like you're not in the political center. And I kind of had to swallow hard, and I said, you know, now that you put it like that, I guess I recognize it's not my ambition to be in the political center, which moves around all the time. My ambition is to be in the moral center. That's why I'm a Democrat. That's why I call myself a progressive, which is a hard-earned title, not just something you slap on a brochure. Because our job is to find what's right the best that we can and bring the political center to us. And I am proud to say after 10 years in office, that was the first time I ever ran for public office, and I won, and I've been reelected 3 times with 99% of the vote. After 10 years, I have gotten done with my colleagues every single thing that I said I wanted to run on. We passed marriage equality in Maryland. We abolished the death penalty, leaving the company of Iraq and Syria and Iran and China and a handful of other governments that still have the death penalty on earth. We restored voting rights to the ex-felons. We passed a ban on military-style assault weapons. We passed the toughest gun safety law in America with my friend Brian Frosch, our great attorney general, who's endorsed my campaign. We did that after Newtown, Connecticut. I have seen democracy work. I have seen government work. We can bring that spirit back to Congress. People say to me, why would you leave being the majority whip of the Senate, chairing all these committees, we get all this stuff done, to go down to Congress where it's deadlocked and it's paralysis all day? That's a 20-second one?
Yeah, okay. No, I should get 10 seconds.
Oh, 10 seconds, okay. Well, the answer is that even with the Citizens United and all the corporate lobbyists and the gerrymandering and all the dysfunction, that's our Congress down there. This is America. It's a democracy we're struggling to be. We cannot give up on Congress, and that's why I want to go.
So let me take you back to Metro. So when I came to Washington in 1975, one of my first jobs was writing editorials for WMAL Radio, and it was a deep dive very quickly into the issues of this area. And one of the first sets of editorials that I wrote was, let's build a metro system. At that point, they were still arguing over it. The funding issues were still very much, who's going to pay for it? How much was the federal role? How much Virginia? How much Maryland? How much D.C.? And a series of editorials was part of that chorus that actually got that metro system to be built here. Fast forward 40 years later, we have not done the regular investment. In fact, we haven't used all the money that was available for capital improvements to make sure our metro system was working. And that's been a series of failed leadership. But I believe we're at a point now where we actually do have great leadership in Weidefeld and also in Jack Evans, a councilman who has been devoting his life to DC, running for mayor, not getting elected, but staying on the city council, and now he is chair of the Metro Board. And Jack Evans has endorsed me in my race for Congress because he says he believes I'm the kind of person he can work with, the kind of person that would be a voice on behalf of Maryland and the 8th District, but also on behalf of the whole metro area for the things that will make this area thrive and prosper in the future. And so that's the insider, but also the outsider voice that I bring to this race. insider in that living here for 40 years, being a journalist for 40 years, interviewing Democrats, Republicans, people from this entire metro area, federal, international, but also local leaders, I know the issues through and through. I've covered those issues from transportation to education to crime, covering the Beltway sniper crisis that had us all held hostage. And that's where my passion for gun safety laws comes from. It's from that historic knowledge of the issues of this area and what people have been looking for in terms of making the area thrive and do better in the future. To be an area where your children's lives will be better than your own, which is the American dream. It's why people come here to this country, because they want that social mobility that we have in our country. And that's what's at risk right now. Our middle class is getting smaller. The wealthier classes are getting wealthier, and the impoverished class is getting larger. And we've got to rebuild and invest in our middle class. Transportation is one part of that, connecting people with where they live in affordable housing to jobs so that they can get to work. And the metro system is the core of that solution here in the area. So we've got to be looking not only at how we, you know, invest in it again, but also what are the new improvements in terms of the Purple Line, which is something that I support, as do all the other Democrats running in this race, so we can connect the eastern and western parts of our county. We also have to look at what's going to make us competitive in the future. My three children were drawn to New York out of college, because New York is a place where you don't need a car, you can take the subway to work, it's got a thriving metropolis. DC is now becoming the most appealing place on, you know, in the country for young people, but it's not going to remain that if you can't live and work in the same area. And that's what we've got to build in. We've got to look at the opportunities for the next generations. I believe that if we make a real commitment in this country to trying to shift from a dirty energy economy into a clean energy economy, and mass transit is a big part of that, that we can actually create new jobs for the future, not only for Maryland, but for our entire country, that are going to be part of this movement towards prosperity and where we want to be in our 21st century. If we put a carbon tax, for example, on dirty fossil fuels to reduce our consumption of petroleum and eventually natural gas, and shift that into clean energy, as incentives for those oil providers to move into the new energy economy, we're going to be creating not only a cleaner planet, but also jobs for the next generation. And I believe if you put a carbon tax in and you put some of that to energy innovation, but a lot of it into mass transit, which will lower our carbon footprint and actually reduce our carbon emissions, you have a win-win. And those are the kind of outsider solutions that somebody who has worked as a journalist, talked to people on all sides of an issue, looked for innovation, looked for new ideas, whether it was education or transportation. And someone who's been in business can bring to the equation. Because in business, you know what it's about. It's about moving things forward. Gridlock is not an option. You have to constantly look and figure out, how do you have growth? How do you create more jobs? How do you create more prosperity? Where are the new ideas? And that's what I think my combination of journalism, but also business, would bring to Metro, or a lot of the solutions that we're looking for here in the Metro area and for our country.
Once again, we're back to insider versus outsider, short-term thinking versus long-term thinking. So if we start with Metro, clearly the insiders have run Metro. Metro is running to the ground. It's not safe. It's not reliable. It's not a long-term investment. It's all short-term. It's all about today. That insider mentality has not worked. Take it a level up, the transportation. In Maryland, we've had two major transportation projects since 1987. Intercounty Connector and the Purple Line's just starting. In Virginia, they've had nine of equal scale. The difference is, again, insiders not liking change. Maryland does lead the country in studies. We do a lot of studies of transportation, and then we study some more, and then we study some more. But all that really feeds up to budgeting. It's about the money in the end of the day. It's about what's right short-term versus long-term. Our budgeting is done by the Congressional Budget Office. The CBO does something called static scoring. Static scoring means they look at a proposal. Maybe it's health care, investment in research for Alzheimer's. Maybe it's infrastructure for transportation. They look at that on a one-year basis, If it's a tax cut, they look at it on 10 years only. But everything else is 1 year. Well, if you look at the long-term benefit, like transportation, metro, investment in Alzheimer's, more smarter immigration policies, all those show negative on a static basis. So a new idea is what we're looking for. They're still using Excel spreadsheets. So a new idea is a project that I'm working on with the Wharton School called the Public Policy Initiative. We've built a giant computer with 30, 40 major data sets, all the census data, mortality data, healthcare data, with the same people, the PhDs at Wharton and Harvard, that used to work at the CBO. And they've worked with the CBO to understand how it works there and said, why are we using outdated technology? Because they always did. No other reason. That's what they're comfortable with in Washington. They're not comfortable with new technology that we in business drive, and that's how we can survive. So this policy is a, we call it the honest budgeting model. It's not Republican, it's not Democrat. It's totally nonpartisan. So we can take ideas from think tanks, from journalists, eventually from consumers, push them into the policy, and the policy can evaluate the Trump tax plan and tell you it's baloney. It can look at the Clinton's tax plan, can look at immigration, can look at infrastructure improvement, and it goes out 75 years. It's dynamic scoring. Scoring means the plus, the positives, and the negatives, the plus and the minus. But that's what we need to do, is change how Congress looks at things. And the way we're going to do that is change the type of people that we send to Congress. If we keep sending the same people year after year to Congress, we're going to continue to get the same result. So we need change. We need new ideas. And this initiative, which my wife and I have endowed at Wharton, will be one of those type initiatives that will work with the CBO side by side, and perhaps eventually replace what they have at the CBO with modern technology.
Next question, we start again here.
Oh, for me again? First? Or, okay.
Majority of Iranian Americans feel that the GOP rhetorics against Muslims, immigrants, and Iranians would lead to discrimination against them. Now, if you are elected to the Congress, what steps would you take to address that?
So the question is what to do in dealing with the Republican rhetoric that is creating discrimination and creating a fear of discrimination. Houri, I'll be blunt. That's what I've been fighting for years. And that's what I believe we collectively have done effectively in defeating those who wanted to take us to war with Iran. I'll give a little example. In October this past year, after I left the State Department, and spoke with Secretary Kerry before I left, and he's like, why are you leaving again? Because it was a pretty good time, and what's going on? I said, because I think I want to run for Congress. And he said, that's right, get in the fight. And it is the fight, and we'll get to the fight. But at that period in October, if you recall, there was a lot of discussion about killing the Iran deal. And there was a rally on the grounds of the Capitol. And Ted Cruz and Donald Trump were the headline speakers, along with the guy with the beard and I don't know, about 47 other people who were very scary types. And I was on Fox News, and I was on one side of the screen, and the leader of the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies, which is a very neoconservative shop, I won't even call it a think tank, I'll just call it a shop, in Washington, and we were going to debate Mark Dubowitz. And the Fox News moderator is in the middle. And while waiting for the interview, I had to listen to Ted Cruz and Donald Trump for about 20 minutes speak hate from the grounds of our Capitol, a hallowed space, a space where Americans have gone to serve, Americans have died for, a place that represents the best of our country. And I heard them spewing hate. I heard them talking about Muslims. I heard them talking about how dangerous Muslims are. Things that we hear today we've heard for months, we've heard for years out in public, but they were happening that day. And then they came to me in the interview and they said, well, what about this Iran deal? And I said, before I get to the Iran deal, I'm gonna first denounce the kind of hate and hate speech that we just heard. And as I was speaking, they cut me off. So the moderator cut me off. That was intentional. Why? Because they don't want to hear the truth. The truth is that we do not have second-class citizens in this country. We should never allow our politicians to make people feel second-class. We should not have the visa waiver bill upended, or visa waivers upended, so that there's now a bill that makes Iranian Americans and Iranians who have citizenship from Europe feel like they are second class. This should not even be a question. My wife is first generation American. My mother-in-law came here from Sri Lanka. Her husband came in on a Fulbright. They were in the West Coast. I have three daughters, so I think about them too much. My wife was born, and she was in the hospital as a little baby to my mother-in-law. And the father was sent home. And when he was sent home, my mother-in-law was waiting with her daughter. Daughter was taken out. And then the doctor came up to my mother-in-law and said, no more brown babies for you. And he forcibly sterilized her. And so even to this day, when I talk to her about it, she lives with us, it's clear to me the impact that one can feel when they're treated like second class or even worse. We have a responsibility, all of us do in this room, and certainly as Americans, to ensure that nobody ever feels like that. When I took on the fight to stand up to, and I will say, I do have insider experience, but I'm not an insider. I stood up to AIPAC at the time when Bush was in the White House, Ahmadinejad was sitting in Tehran, AIPAC was dominant in Washington politics on the Middle East, and I helped start an organization from my house to fight against that. But my friends told me that was career suicide. Clearly, we've seen the results of it, which is that we have a better foreign policy, a more peaceful one, and I have flourished. We can do well, and we can do better by doing good. The key is to be together, to be voting, to be doing what you're doing here, to be taking on the fights, to have confidence. When I talk to my daughters about the hate that they see on TV coming out of the GOP primaries, which they do here, they're 9, 7, and 5, they're smart, they know what's going on, they ask me about what we'll do, and what I say is, that's why I'm running for Congress. We're gonna fight that. Thank you.
Do you guys know a group called CAIR, C-A-I-R? So they came to Annapolis on Friday and they gave me an award. They brought a 50 or 60 high school and middle school kids and they gave me an award for standing up for the civil rights and civil liberties of Muslims and other minorities in the country. And I got to spend about an hour with the kids. So I'm gonna answer your question the way I addressed the group. And what I said was that America is not one race, it's not one ethnicity, it's not one language, it's not one political party, it's not one religion, it's not one ideology, it's not one system, but we have one thing that unites us all, and it's the Constitution of the United States. And what the Republicans are doing now collides directly with the constitutional faith of the country. So Donald Trump says, let's have a ban on any Muslim immigrants coming into America. Okay? Well, if you say you're Muslim, we'll stop you from coming in. Well, number one, it's stupid, because any terrorist who wants to get in the country will just say they're Christian or something else, right? So it doesn't make any sense. But two, it's completely antithetical to every major aspect of our Constitution. Free exercise of religion, no establishment of a religion, freedom of association, freedom of press, freedom of speech, equal production of the laws, due process of the laws, no religious test for public office, no religious test for citizenship. These are the things that define us as Americans. So send a constitutional law professor to go do battle with Ted Cruz and Donald Trump. I would enjoy it. I was listening to this wonderful story Joel told about being on TV, and I was reflecting back to the time I was invited to go on O'Reilly Factor show. And the Ninth Circuit had rendered a ruling in a case called Newdow versus United States. I don't know if you remember it, but Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, a very conservative panel of judges who had been appointed by Republicans, ruled that it was indeed unconstitutional to have one nation under God in the Pledge of Allegiance. And they said it violated the Establishment Clause. So it created a lot of outrage, and I wrote something about the case, so I got invited to go on the O'Reilly Factor show. And he said, you know, you liberal law professors, you know, always standing up for people's civil liberties, but we've had one nation under God in our Pledge of Allegiance for 50 years. If it's not one nation under God, what are you? I said, well, you know, if you're an originalist like Justice Scalia, you go back to the original Pledge of Allegiance, which didn't have one nation under God in it. It was written by Francis Bellamy, a Baptist minister, who wrote it on the 400th anniversary of the arrival of Columbus to the New World. And he said, I pledge allegiance to my flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And it was written to stick it to the Confederate states where they were still saluting the Confederate battle flag. That's why he said, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Those were words that stuck in the craw of the rebel, unreconstructed rebel sympathizers in the South who were still saluting the battle flag. So he said, well, we're not interested in that. It would change with Eisenhower's one nation under God. If we're not one nation under God, what are we? And I said, I don't know, one nation under Canada, maybe? You know, this would be geographically correct. And I said, no, really, if you want to be one nation under something, how about one nation under the Constitution? Because it's one Constitution and one constitutional faith that unites us, and that is what the Republican Party, in its current guise of racism, nativism, xenophobia, and increasingly fascistic type tactics, like inviting protesters into rallies and turning mobs on them, that the Republican Party is at war with the basic values and principles of the country. So let me just give you one example of where I would have been on my feet immediately fighting. They passed a law saying that European citizens who were born in Syria, Iraq, or Iran could not come to the US with their French or UK passport or German passport. You've got to go get a special visa. Well, that's an outrage. They could then turn around and do that to us. So if you're a US citizen and you were born in Iran or Iraq or Syria, you couldn't go to Europe without a visa. I mean, is this where things are headed? I mean, kind of ethnic and racial profiling and stereotyping? When I first got into office, there was a scandal because the Maryland State Police were spying on nonviolent political groups. They had money from some of the 9/11 national security funds, and so they started spying on peace groups, anti-death penalty groups, environmental groups, pro-choice groups, anti-choice groups. So one of my constituents called me up and said, Senator Raskin, we're Quakers. If there's an ant in the kitchen, we put it on a napkin and we walk it outside, and they put us on a terrorist watch list. So I introduced legislation which passed unanimously, with Democratic and Republican support, unanimously to say no spying on nonviolent political groups in our state unless there's a factual predicate for reasonable suspicion or probable cause that criminal acts are taking place. And we got the strongest civil liberties law in America now because of that.
I'm confident that Hillary Clinton will be elected our next president, but I'm not taking it for granted. And I don't think any of us can. A year ago, I think many of us, Frank Islam, who's really helping elect Hillary, many of us thought she was a shoo-in. But it's been unbelievable to watch what's happened in this presidential election and the enthusiasm. I can't believe I can even use that word, the enthusiasm that has been generated for Donald Trump's candidacy within a lot of people who feel very disenfranchised in this country. These are folks that feel like the economy has not been helping them, that they have been suffering with a lot of the policies and also just the shrinking of our middle class. And they are finding in Donald Trump somebody that they think will fix things for them. And so we've got to make sure that we as Democrats unite. And I think Bernie Sanders has done a great job of raising a lot of important issues, but Hillary Clinton is the person who can beat Donald Trump in November. And I think as Democrats, we've got to unite behind her because she is the person that's got the broadest domestic but also the foreign policy experience that will really make a difference for this country. And that's why I'm enthusiastically, I have endorsed her and gave her money when she first announced that she was running for office. Now that said, how do we make sure that her vision is a vision that is one of inclusiveness and that it is one that is embraced by our country and by the majority of people here? I think one of the reasons that I was drawn to the travel industry after a long career in journalism is because I do believe that the more we are able to visit other countries and the more people are able to visit our country, the better off the world is. because it's when you visit each other and cultures mix that you see that we are more similar than we are different. And people who come to the United States see what a great country we have. They see what our progressive values are. They see our moral center when they come and visit here. They fall in love with this country. And that's why one of the things that I was most dedicated to in my journal, in my career at Marriott, was not promoting the company. That was sort of what my job was of my predecessor. I expanded the job to be an ambassador and an advocate for global travel, to make, after 9/11, it easier for people to safely travel, but also to travel freely. I was a huge advocate of the visa waiver program. I appeared at global forums in the Middle East, in Europe, in Asia, talking about the benefits of the visa waiver program. A program where you do really robust research about people because governments are sharing data. They're sharing all their data because they want to make sure that trusted travelers have freedom of travel. And what we saw after Paris was a step back to the world of 9/11. It was going backwards, saying, oh no, most people can travel from these countries except a few people. And suddenly the thresholds that were put up, people that had dual citizenship, people that had traveled to one of the countries in question that were suddenly suspect, could not travel. It was a step backwards. We've got to move forward again. And that's why I support the Equal Protection in Travel Act, which has got both Democratic and Republican support right now. We need to get that passed. It's the kind of thing that you should be writing Chris Van Hollen and Barbara Mikulski and Ben Cardin right now saying, we must pass this law, let's move it forward. And it would start to create more freedom around the visa waiver program. Because, as Jamie said, if you have a dual passport, how many people have dual citizenship in this room? Okay? How many of you go back and forth between here and Iran or many of these countries? Because you have family there, right? You should not be on those watch lists. You should not have that extra scrutiny because you are trusted travelers. You've hit those thresholds. There are smarter ways with the data collection and the data sharing that we can get at making sure that we make sure that people who should be on watch lists are on the watch list. And we've got to move that forward. I actually advocated for the expansion of the visa waiver program beyond Europe, but to more countries like Brazil, like South Korea, because you know what happens? When we have visa waiver like that between these countries, people come visit America. And during the period of the economic downturn, we had millions more visitors come here from South Korea, from many of these countries with visa waiver, and that created jobs in America, jobs here that can't be outsourced. For every 30 international visitors that come to the U.S., you create one new U.S. job in a hotel company, at an airport, at a retail business, even at Total Wine, I bet, you create new jobs. People coming and actually spending their dollars here. This is the world we need to create. We need to create a world where we have trusted travelers, smart security information, more cooperation among our allies, and we have the ability to make new allies. And that's the vision I think Hillary Clinton is embracing and the vision we have to make sure she's elected to carry out.
I'm certainly in total agreement with the points that Kathleen brought up, Jamie and Joel. Immigration is what made America great. The visa waiver program, opening up our doors to students and entrepreneurs to come to America, that's where we need to be. And that's how we got to be who we are. And what Trump and the Republican Party has done is just so impossible, so disgusting, so wrong. We all can see that. But let's take a second what we don't agree on. And that's how did we get here exactly? Because we've arrived at this where some folks think that's okay. Now, I'm a huge supporter of Hillary, and I believe Hillary's going to win, for sure. It's not optional. She has to win. But at the end of the day, we've arrived at this divisiveness through a couple of things. Two things in particular. Gerrymandering and money in politics. The gerrymandering, which we have here in Maryland, the worst state in the country for Democratic gerrymandering. We're number one. There we are. We might be number 47 for people that want to stay in Maryland. That's not a good number to be, 40. We did beat Connecticut and Illinois. But we're number one on gerrymandering, the Democratic side. The Republicans are equally guilty. But what this has done is it's led to everybody living on the edges. 25,000 to 30,000 folks out of a district of 900,000 people will elect the next congressman here. And we'll elect the next congressman in each of the vast majority of the districts across the United States. When you have such a small group electing your officials, you don't get diversity. We don't get differences of opinion. And we don't get, from there, accountability to everybody in the room, everybody in the district. Instead, the Tea Party can hijack the party, or the liberal left can hijack the party on the Democratic side. And no one is meeting in the middle. And then we get these horrible policies that we see are all over the country right now. So we need a national commission. It needs to be 10 or 15 years out. The idea of doing something with Virginia is silly. But at the bottom line is that we need to attack the problems that's behind what we see. And that's the gerrymandering, and it's the money. The money in politics, the lobbyist money, the PAC money. Yes, everyone needs a seat at the table so we can see your point of view, and we can see your point of view. And that's important. We need both points of view. But we don't need three seats at the table for one person and only one seat for the other person. That's not moving us in a positive direction. And that's the reason why in this campaign, my wife and I decided we're not going to take any money. So we're not out fundraising, we're taking no PAC money, we're taking no lobby money, and we're taking nothing more than 10 bucks. So we're paying our own way, because we've been lucky, we've been fortunate. And so you know what, this is the chance to try and do something to make a difference, to step up and change things. Because the old ways are clearly not working. We need ideas, we need change. And the money is clearly preventing that. So if that resonates, I think that's an important piece that we all have to think about. And from that, we can get better immigration policies. We can get better budgeting policies. And we can think about thinking long term, not just short term. The short term is what's got us here. The every 2 years elections, that's what's got us here. The fundraising that takes up 60% of a congressman's time, 60%, is out asking for money. I have no interest in asking for money. So my position is, we'll have a little more time to do the work, to get out and focus on getting stuff done. Yeah, listen to both sides equally and make the smart decision. And then build alliances with people all over the country, Democrats, Republicans, together as Americans. That's who we are. We're not just D's and R's. And I think I can get a head start on that in Congress, having businesses in 101 districts around the country. So I know a lot of folks. We have a lot of team members, a lot of employees all over America, and that's a good way to get started.
There's been a request to allow a rebuttal to responses. I don't think we have enough time for it, but if all four of you agree, we can allow 60 seconds. Is that acceptable to all of you?
Sure.
Who's first?
The first? Okay, great.
Okay.
So thanks. Hi. Good news is that I have no responsibility for any gerrymandering or any of the money in politics. And I say that sincerely because I agree, those are major problems. As the only candidate here who has spent his entire career in public service, be it a nonprofit or in government, I'm not coming in with a massive amount of funds that I can self-finance my own campaign. I have not hired lobbyists around the country, I have not donated millions of dollars to the Democrats or hundreds of thousands of Republicans. I just bring me, and that's 20 years of experience getting things done in Washington, taking on tough, hard fights. I also don't like gerrymandering because my wife is a Republican staffer on Capitol Hill. She's very stressed about what's happening right now, clearly in her party. She's a very liberal person. But what that means is I also frankly understand what it's like to think, live, and work with diversity. I live it. We are a mixed couple in politics, in cultural identity. And what it also means is that frankly, she can't vote for me in this election. She's blocked out. So I ask you to think about that, the track record and what one brings, not just the words, but what they've done. Thank you.
The Washington Post has an op-ed this morning by Rob Ritchie, who's executive director of America's leading electoral reform think tank called Fair Vote, praising the legislation I've introduced in this session of the Maryland legislature to create an interstate compact between Maryland and Virginia, so we will create one redistricting commission for both states so we can get out of this together. The problem is you can't just do it in one state, and here's why. In 2012, Democrats got 1.5 million votes more than Republicans did across the country in U.S. House elections, but the Republicans ended up with 33 more seats than we did. That's because they controlled more than 30 of the state legislatures, and they gerrymandered the districts. They sliced and diced. Understand this, gerrymandering is the linchpin of Republican control of the U.S. House of Representatives and of Congress. So, Mr. Trone and Ms. Mathews have been beating me up about the fact that I voted for the Democratic plan for redistricting, which was a gerrymander, instead of the Republican plan for redistricting, which was a gerrymander. Those were the choices presented to us, but I've got a way to get us out of it. And I would invite them to lobby all of their Republican friends, because both of them have been responsible for giving hundreds of thousands of dollars to Republicans across the country. Lobby your Republican friends for gerrymandering. Don't just blame the Democrats for it. We got a plan to get through this thing.
So I'm really proud that last week the Washington Post endorsed me of the nine candidates in this race for Congress. And they cited my deep knowledge of the area as a reporter and my broad public affairs experience, but also being most in the tradition of Chris Van Hollen as a person who could reach across the aisle, build bridges, and get things done. I'm also proud of the 8,000 people who have given me campaign contributions. 8,000 people, 80% of which are $100 or less. That's the system we have. If we had everybody self-funding campaigns, you would have a Congress of entirely billionaires. The campaign system we have is you reach out broadly, first to your family, then your friends, then people whose kids went to school with your kids, your neighbors, people you worked with in business, and you say, do you believe in my campaign? Do you believe I'm the best qualified person? Do you think I will be your representative and your voice? And 8,000 people plus have done that in my campaign, and I'm incredibly proud of that. I'm also proud of the 300 people who are volunteering on my campaign. My entire field campaign, every lawn sign you see put up is by a volunteer. The phone calls, they've called 300,000 households. We have knocked on 100,000 doors, all volunteers, 65 of whom are interns. That's the kind of campaign I believe in. That's the kind of campaign I think that is broadly grassroots, and that's the kind of campaign I believe that will be a winning campaign in 2016.
Back to gerrymandering one more time. Either you like gerrymandering or you don't like it. You either vote for it or you vote against it. And, you know, Jamie took the vote, he voted for it. And because somebody else did it in Texas, I don't think that cuts the mustard, but that's your choice to decide on that. At the end of the day, it's a, as I mentioned earlier, it's a national fix. It has to be done there. Nothing's going to happen to us working with the state of Virginia. Bill Howe, the Speaker of the House of Virginia, you can forget that happening. It's just silly. But bottom line is, campaign finance is certainly what we need here. Three of the four members are all multimillionaires here. I'm sorry, Joel.
I've been out.
You didn't make the cut. So to say that, you know, there's not a lot of money on the dais here, there certainly is. We all have lots and lots of hundreds and hundreds of volunteers working for us. And we also have a lot of money we spend on media. All of us are up on media, we're all up on TV, so it's not just like only folks that are willing to spend their own money. Is there something wrong with spending your own money? I don't know, I'm not so sure I grabbed that, not sure I got that. But the willingness to spend your own money, not to be beholden to somebody else, to only be beholden to the voters in the district, I think that's probably a good thing at the end of the day. And gerrymandering, which lets the politicians pick their voters versus the voters picking their politician, I think that's probably not a good thing either. But that's for you guys to decide.
The next question is starts from Mr. Trone, actually, and then we come this way. Mr. Trone, the poll shows that most voters believe that the Congress doesn't work because of the GOP gridlock. If you are elected in the Congress, what steps, what would you do to resolve that, or to work around the GOP?
That's a great question. So the polls are showing that nothing's working in Congress because the GOP gridlock. 14% is the approval rating right now in Congress. 14. If our kids got that, not good for school. The reelection rate in Congress is 96%. There's something not connecting there. Clear disconnect. And the disconnection, of course, is the money and the power of incumbency that they continue to reelect and reelect and reelect. The only way we're going to get something done in Congress is we change the type of people we're sending. Again, we can't just keep sending the same career politicians, folks that have only ever been on the public service, just work for the government. That's not what we need. We need folks that have created jobs, created businesses, created opportunity for others, and looking for new ideas, looking for change. As I mentioned earlier, with businesses in 101 congressional districts in America, I know a lot of governors all over America. I know a lot of state senate presidents, a lot of speakers, a lot of legislators. We've passed laws in almost all of those states, pro-consumer laws such as Sunday sales. That'd be good. I think everybody would agree. The ability to sell craft beer. I passed that law with help in North and South Carolina. The ability to have wine and beer and spirit tastings. So we have lobbyists actually in 17 states around the country. And I understand they've written checks to Republicans. God forbid. But you know what? If you want to get something done in Texas, South Carolina, or North Carolina, you better work with Republicans. And I'm okay with that. We can disagree with them on progressive issues completely. But on a narrow band of pro-consumer things that support my thousands of team members across the country and make better jobs with better medical plans and all those type of things, we need to work with Republicans together across the aisle. And that's how we're going to get stuff done.
So one of the things you learn as a journalist is how to talk to all people. You also learn how to listen and process what people are telling you. And you develop relationships with people on of all political parties. What you learn in a big corporation is how you build consensus. Because if you're just an individual performer in a big corporation, you don't get anything done. Because it takes building alliances across disciplines and learning how to work together to actually achieve common goals. And that requires diplomacy. It requires putting forth a good business argument. And those are the skills I think I brought from my 9 years at Marriott International. A certain humility that you can't do it by yourself, you gotta do it with other people. And I don't think there's enough of that kind of humility, but also not enough of those kind of skills right now in our Congress. People have come in from partisan backgrounds and state legislatures, and they've come in from being career Democrats and career Republicans, and we need more people, I think, with the skills to be able to reach and build those bridges across the aisle. And let me give you some examples. When I was at Marriott, I worked with Senator Amy Klobuchar, who was chair of the Senate Travel Caucus. Together, we worked on being able to create a Travel Promotion Act. The U.S. was the only major country in the world that did not promote travel to our country. States promoted it, but our country didn't. India has incredible India. Great Britain has Great Britain is great. They all promote travel to their country because they know it creates jobs. And so with Amy Klobuchar, we started working and the Obama administration on a bill to create a Travel Promotion Act, a hybrid of a public-private partnership to promote travel here to create jobs and also prosperity. But she couldn't get it done in a Republican Senate. So she found with us somebody who also cared about travel and tourism, Senator Roy Blunt, who is from a state that has a lot of tourism, Missouri, because they have Branson, and they want people to come to Branson in the same way that Amy wants them to come to Minneapolis, where you have the Mall of America. Together, they worked on that bill, and we got it done. And we created 1 million jobs in the economic downturn because of that bill and the travel promotion to the United States. Right now, you've got other examples of bipartisanship, and it's a matter of finding the right people. Senator Jeff Flake is actually working with Dick Durbin on the Equal Protection Travel Bill. This is to address these visa waiver inequities that we were talking about. We need to support both of them and that kind of bipartisan solution. Congressman Jerry Connolly is actually leading the way with a Republican to make sure that we have a commission that looks at the enforcement of the Iranian nuclear agreement so that we can actually trust it's being enforced going forward so it doesn't fall apart through partisan bickering that almost prevented it from getting passed. These are examples, and it takes a certain kind of skill set and a certain kind of person who actually wants to talk to other people, who believes in relationships, actually likes people, and wants to work with them. And I hope that those are the skills that you would see that I would bring to this race to try to get things done.
So I'm a middle child. I don't know if we've got fellow middle children out there. But you know, all of the books say it's the middle children who try to make peace between everybody in the family. And so this is my personality. And this gives me the opportunity, thank you for this wonderful question, to state that just for my friend David Trone, who's been somehow saying I can't deal with Republicans, the General Assembly has enacted more than 100 of my bills, 118 bills, we looked it up, and 95% of them had Republican sponsors and support. And a majority of them had majority or unanimous support from Republicans. I'll give you a couple examples that I'm doing right now. I've got legislation to compel convicted domestic offenders to surrender their firearms at the point of conviction, because the chances of a woman or a child being killed in a domestically abusive household go up 500% if there's a gun in the house. And I'm doing that with Republicans who are my co-sponsors. We wouldn't get that through with all of them. Another bill, you probably heard of this, Noah's Law. Noah's Law, there have been some terrible drunk driving accidents around here with people dying. Well, Noah Leota, a 24-year-old kid, a son of Montgomery County, went to Montgomery College, became a cop, went on the drunk driving unit on the police task force, pulled over a drunk driver on December 6, 2015, brought the guy's license and registration back to his car. On his way back to the car, another car comes and hits him, another drunk driver. The guy had been drinking for 4 hours at Hooters. And so this is legislation I've been putting in for 7 years with my friend Ben Kramer on the House side. We got half of it done, so we have ignition interlock device for repeat drunk drivers and for people who hit a 0.15, but now it will be for everybody. Anybody, you get stopped for drunk driving, you blow a 0.08, you get the interlock device put in your car, we will save 50 or 60 lives a year. We'll be able to cut the drunk driving fatality rate now. And I'm doing it with the Republicans, and I'm doing it over the opposition of Big Liquor, which has opposed me on that, on every piece of drunk driving legislation we've had. I did it over the opposite. And speaking of which, when I first got elected, I heard from a lot of Republicans, we can't have wine shipped to our houses because Big Liquor set it up, you got to go to the liquor store. So I said, that's crazy. You can have a car shipped to your house. You can have wine shipped to your house? I said, no. So with a number of conservative Republicans and progressive Democrats, we put in legislation to say you can have direct wine shipment to your house. Everybody said, don't do that. The leadership doesn't want it. The leadership are the people who don't want you to do anything in the legislative process. We doubled the number of co-sponsors in the second year. In the third year, we doubled it. We had marches. We had wine tastings. And if you don't remember anything else about me, remember I'm the guy who brought you direct wine shipment against Big Liquor in the state. But look, this is serious business about big money. And this election is the most expensive congressional race in America. According to the New York Times is already here, the national press has settled upon it, okay? We gotta start with this principle. Public office is something that you earn. It's not something that you buy. And we have to vindicate that principle. It's a very important one. An election is not an auction. It's not about who can spend the most money. It's not about who can put the most ads on the air, whether it's coming out of your own pocket or from corporate PAC money, which would seem to be the two choices that are offered to us here. I am proud that we have more than 12,000 individual donations that we've received in our campaign. 80% of the money is in $100 or less, and the vast majority of it comes from right here in Maryland, not from all other parts of America. Okay, so we are running the grassroots campaign here against the big money process. Now, both of these guys, who are wonderful people, are identified with corporations, and you know, it is important for us, but it's also easy for us to denounce what's going on in the Republican Party because the language is incendiary, it's demeaning, and it's un-American, really, what they're saying. But there's another insidious threat that you see in the rise of Donald Trump. It's not just the nativism, the racism, it's the corporatism. It's the idea that he's a corporation, and he's saying, I don't have to take any money from anybody because I've made it, and I've got my own money, and I'm going to spend it. So it seems like the choices come down to either we take people from corporations who will go in and represent themselves and their corporations, or we take people who are taking all the corporate PAC money and it's going to them, as opposed to people who are going to stand up for the public interest and the common good. The framers figured this out in the Federalist Papers. Madison wrote about it, Hamilton wrote about it. They said, the whole trick is, can you get people who go to public office to stand for the common good and not for special interests, special factions that they called them. I am not a career politician. I am a career law professor, but I've gone into politics and I've been very good at it, and I hope you send me to Congress too.
So the good news, I'll go to the question first. The good news in terms of how do we unlock this Gordian knot of getting things done with the Republican majorities, and the answer is right here in this room. Let's think about this. The Iran deal that got through a Republican majority Congress is the single best, most progressive achievement we have seen in the last decade get through a Republican Congress. So you all, right now, should think you have the key, you have the wisdom. And I'm proud to be associated with that. I fought the House Republicans tooth and nail every day as an activist at J Street, at Plowshares Fund, and then at the State Department as a senior official every day fighting the Republicans to explain, yeah, you know what? This deal is going to help our country. It's going to help Iran. It's going to build security. It's going to promote peace. These are values, though, that cut across everybody. These aren't just Democratic values or Republican values, but there is a system in place, and there is a process that one has to understand in order to get it done. And I believe, you know, frankly, without the support of the Iranian-American community, there is no way that we would have gotten that deal through, and there is no way that we would have had a situation right now where we would be in a peaceful situation with Iran. I can guarantee that Iran would have gone for the bomb, they were a couple weeks away, and we would have had to deal with the question of military action. We don't, thankfully. But we do have to watch every single day GOP attacks against this bill. And that's why you need people in Congress who do have experience working with Congress every day. I'm the only candidate who has spent every single day for years now working directly with the House of Representatives at a senior level and as an activist to make sure that we get things done. And there are a lot of foxes in that hen house. There are a lot of people who want to find ways to undermine the deal. For example, my friend is maybe in the back, this repeal of the visa bill, or essentially eliminating the waiver, this is intentional. This wasn't done just to go after Iranian Americans and just out of hatred of Iranians, which we all know is part of it. It's also done to undermine the deal. It's done to undermine the ability of the business community to go there. It's no coincidence that a close friend of my wife's, Siamak Namazi, is in Avon prison. My wife is a young global leader with the World Economic Forum. Siamak and his father. All right, let's take a moment. Sorry, I choked up about when my wife heard about it. It's very personal. It's not a surprise that he's in prison. He represents the future. You all represent the future. And it's the same thing here. When that visa waiver bill was repealed for Iranians, it's an attack against you, and it's an attack against peace, and it's an attack against the deal. Now, I think we have to make sure that when we're sending people to Congress, that we know that they are representing us, that we know that they are representing the values that we hold, and that they know that they're putting people in who have the heart and the tenacity and the determination to take on multi-year fights. Because that's what we're up against. And with the GOP, that's the only way you work it, time and again, working with the communities that care most and making things happen. Thank you for all of your efforts.
Well, first of all, our company, Total Wine & More, leads the nation in support for moderation in drinking. We've been honored and recognized all over the country for our work with the United States Ad Council, Be My Designated Driver, etc. We fully support interlocked systems. We want to deal with the problem that alcoholism is, and we deal with it responsibly and directly and full support. The concept of wine shipping, this is one of his favorite ones. We do it 14 times now. And so we think wine shipping by wineries is great. We support that bill. It's all over the country, and I always laugh that Maryland managed to do it 42nd. So 41 states got wine shipping done before it got to Annapolis. Now Annapolis did beat Alabama, and they beat Mississippi and a few other states. So congratulations, you know, we moved into the 20th century ahead of Mississippi. Way to go. End of the day, big liquor is what stops my business from expanding here in Maryland. Big liquor is what Annapolis is, controlled by the small package stores all over the state that don't want competition. We're the retail that brings low prices. We're hated by the folks that want to charge more and offer less selection and less service. We're the exact opposite. We fought big liquor all over the United States. So the irony of that is kind of mind-boggling. Maryland, you're allowed to own one store. That's it. That's not right.
So we're a month away from the election, and so you're seeing kind of this campaign conversation in a whole new light. The knives are out. People are, you know, you're seeing the real campaign suddenly take shape here, because we're getting very close to a very tough decision, and we have nine candidates, in all of whom, in any other congressional district in the country, would be the leading candidate, because we have people with amazing skills. Three state legislators, two people who worked in the Obama administration, two successful people from business, the business community, a former journalist, all of us who have really invested our heart and souls in this campaign, but also in this community. And I just would ask you, as you listen to sort of the charges and the sniping going on, to think about a couple things. Who's going to be the person most in the tradition of Chris Van Hollen? Chris, who is so revered in this district, who you know, has 85% approval ratings among his constituents because he really serves this area, who is most in his tradition? But I'd also ask you to look at something else, and that is the diversity of our Congress. We have a Congress in which only 20% of the members are women, between the House and the Senate, 20%. And we're losing Barbara Mikulski, who was one of the longest serving women in our Congress, first in the House and now in the Senate. And I think that we need more women in Congress. We need more diverse members in Congress. We need more diverse experience in Congress. And I hope you'll consider that as you think about who you're going to vote for on April 26.
Do you want to offer a 60-second response?
Can I just say one thing about our friend Chris Van Hollen?
Yeah,
first of all, Chris Van Hollen came out and endorsed me when I first ran for the state Senate against that 32-year incumbent, which was an extraordinary thing, because incumbents don't like to endorse people against other incumbents. And so when Chris called me and said, Jamie, Mikulski's stepping down, I'm going to run for Senate, will you endorse me? I said, not only will I endorse you, I'll run for your seat. I knew immediately I wanted to do it, and I also knew immediately I wanted to endorse him. My friend Kathleen didn't endorse Crystal a few weeks ago. For several months,
I gave him money 2 days after he announced. I maxed out for him 2 days after he announced.
All right.
That was the endorsement. He didn't ask me for my endorsement.
Okay.
When he finally did, I said, of course I'd be honored to endorse you.
Okay. So
I gave him $100,000.
Everybody participates however they can. But let me just say, I have worked really closely with Chris. And my office is small. We only have one legislative assistant, and I get an administrative assistant during this session. But I prided myself on the fact that I was named the most responsive elected official in Montgomery County by the Silver Spring Voice. My office works really closely with Chris Van Hollen's office. I endorsed him immediately because I think he's going to be a terrific senator. He spent 12 years in Annapolis, in the State House and then in the State Senate, learning the skills of parliamentary advocacy, coalition building, crossing the aisle, hanging tough, and making progress. That's how we do it in Maryland. And some people seem to have contempt for local and state government. I don't. That's the American system.
Sure, why not? One more bite of the apple. So I don't have contempt for money in politics because our for state government. It's not contempt, it's just an analysis of what we need to make sure that we're getting the kind of people in the government that will actually serve the public. I'll give one example as well on getting things done in a bipartisan way. I won an award when I was a congressional staffer, a staffer of the year, that was a bipartisan award for protecting military health care. You can get things done. You don't have to donate money. You don't have to beat people up. You have to work with them every day and identify common areas where you can make things happen. And this will be not only the most expensive House race, it's going to be the most expensive race in the state. It's probably going to be more expensive than the Senate race, which is a real odd dichotomy for all of us, and certainly for me as someone who is committed to public service. But I tell you, watching this and watching the money coming into this race, it is very hard to explain to my daughters about why it is that they can't necessarily hear all the candidates the same. They see different signs go up. I think we owe everybody in this election, and I applaud Kathleen for what he said, I think we owe everybody in this election the opportunity to hear every voice. There are many good voices that want to get in. My fear is that this election will discourage people from running for public office, which will narrow the kinds of people we send, which will harm our ability to have people in Congress who really do represent a broad swath of experience. Thank you.
So this will be our last question. Since the candidates have actually responded to a few questions that I had in mind to ask them, and you have already answered them very, very clearly. The last question
before you ask your question,
yes,
very quickly, since I'll make a statement, I'm going to head out and let you guys do your thing.
But thank you very much for listening to the statement, and hopefully you will take into consideration what I said about Will.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
So, should the government top two priorities be in dealing with Iran now after the nuclear deal is passed?
Should we start from the middle with
Kathleen? I would start with. Oh.
I supported the Iranian nuclear agreement, and I looked really hard at it, and I heard from all sides on that issue. I talked to AIPAC to see what their real concerns were. I talked to J Street. Actually, there are three of us here, Joel, Jamie, and I, who are on the street with J Street because of the stand we took in favor of that nuclear agreement. I talked to the Muslim community. I talked to the Christian community, all of whom are very concerned about the situation we have in the Middle East right now, and are all very intent on what the best pathway to peace and security is in that region. And after taking a hard look, my poor impulses kicked in, and that is a belief that diplomacy and negotiation are a much better pathway than war. And I saw the alternative to that agreement being potentially going to war, whether it was Israel and Iran in engagement or the U.S. having to come in. I saw a dire scenario if we didn't give peace and negotiation a chance. That said, I also am deeply suspicious of the Iranian government that's in place. And I look at the Iranian government as being very different from the Iranian people. The Iranian people that I've gotten to know who've come over to this country, but also people who have been at global forums with me who I've gotten to know. And so as I look at that government, I have deep suspicion of that government. My husband was in the Carter administration when the hostages were taken. I saw what that did to his presidency, to our country. And I also covered hostages when they came home as a reporter, because many of them were from the DC area, whether they were Marine guards or whether they were diplomats. And that regime is still essentially the same regime in place. And I believed only an agreement would help us move forward towards potentially empowering the moderate forces in Iran. And that, I thought, was a good reason to support that agreement. Make sure that the nuclear weapons were not being created, but also to empower and give hope to what we hear is great moderate leadership that is ready to awaken in Iran. But for it to work, we got to make sure that it's enforced. And Congressman Jerry Connolly, together with a Republican, has proposed something that I think is a really good idea. And I think that would be my first priority. It is to have an executive branch, State Department, Commerce, Homeland Security, plus Congress, group of people that are constantly looking at the agreement and making sure that it's enforced. We also do have to have travel between the countries. If we have those sanctions removed, but business people can't travel back and forth, that's not going to empower the economy there. And a good economy in Iran is going to be good for moderate forces in Iran. So we got to make sure we have that travel going back and forth. So that would be a second thing that I would prioritize. But I think the most important thing is for us as a country to look for ways that we try to find more alliances of moderate Muslim leadership in that region, and not only to be looking at the situation in Iran, but to also be looking to the two-state solution in Israel, which I think is another part of the tinderbox in the Middle East. And the U.S. needs to be the leader in engaging in these things. We were the leader in terms of the Iranian nuclear agreement. We have to take a leadership role in terms of the two-state solution. We can be the power, I think, towards peace and prosperity. It's our responsibility, but it's also our opportunity as a leader in the world. And so that's how I would prioritize sort of the next steps forward. And I'm really optimistic about it. I'm going to head out pretty quickly because my husband's putting our Easter dinner in the oven right now. And I have family members arriving at 6:30 for Easter dinner. But I just want to thank all of you for your incredible attention today and also just being so engaged on these issues. I mean, for you to spend your Sunday afternoon in this beautiful home here and to really be looking towards making a wise decision about your next member of Congress. And I salute you for doing it, and I think we as candidates have had a tremendous opportunity, and I thank you for giving us this chance to get in front of you.
Mr. Trone, would you like to go next?
So I would echo what, Kathleen said. We clearly start with a two-state solution in Israel. That's part of the whole situation. We need that. We have to continue to work on it. But it's really about, again, long-term thinking. We have to be thinking long-term, and we have to be patient. There's no solution that's going to jump out and just change things overnight. But absolutely, the government is a major issue. The people want to move, and clearly the moderates are making a little bit of progress, not a lot, but a little bit of progress, but that progress will be continual. And we need to encourage the intersection of Western culture, Iran, and build more travel, build more immigration, build more education, and these educational opportunities help make America more familiar, more comfortable, more accessible to the folks in Iran. And we have to build business ties. The stronger the Iranian economy is, the more opportunities the folks in the giant middle class and the lower class in Iran are going to be able to gain power, and the moderates won't continually be shut out. In the last election, there was some movement, but it wasn't near enough movement. But this connectivity, this patience, this slow building, and of course supporting what the president has put forth, we certainly support the Iranian deal. It's the right thing. It's stopped us from the brink, and now we have to make it work. And that's just going to take, again, long-term thinking and long-term commitment from two peoples that should naturally connect very well. So thank you again for coming out today. Awesome house, awesome event, and thank you so much.
My views on foreign policy flow out of my views on domestic policy. And what I believe in internationally is what I believe in nationally. I believe in democracy. I believe in human rights. I believe in the rule of law. I believe in civil rights. I believe in civil liberties. I believe in free markets. And I believe in strong democracy. And I think that's got to be the pathway forward for Iran and for all of the peoples of the earth.
I, too, was a strong champion of the Iran nuclear agreement. It cut off a plutonium pathway to the bomb. It cut off the uranium pathway to the bomb. It snapped back sanctions that my wife will help to implement unilaterally if we think that the Iranian government is in breach of the agreement. This is going to be the way forward. This is what the great liberals of the 18th century thought would be the way forward for the peoples of the world. The more that countries became liberal democracies, the more that they would deal with each other through diplomacy, through discussion, cultural engagement, economic trade, and the liberalizing, humanizing endeavors, as opposed to war and mercantilism and the vision that it's every country, every people against every other country and every other people. So. The Iranian government needs serious reform. It's a theocratic regime. They don't work. It's autocratic. What was the great gift of the American Revolution and the American Constitution to the rest of the world? Yes, we were the first nation on earth conceived in revolution against monarchy and against theocracy. The idea that church and government should be blended together so that the government could use religion to control the people and religion could use government to confuse people. So we separated them against centuries of religious warfare between Catholics and Protestants and Inquisition and Holy Crusades and witchcraft trials, all of it. And Jefferson and Madison and George Mason and Governor Morris and all of them, to their great everlasting credit, said we've got to separate church and state and have free markets. And that's why we continue to be the beacon to the rest of the world, people who would be killing each other. I met yesterday with Balkan Americans, and they said people who would be killing each other today, Bosnians and Serbs, people from different religions, come over here and they have restaurants right next door to each other. Because people respect each other's freedom of religion, freedom of speech and association, we figure out how to do it. The Republican Party's threatening all of that today. They're threatening to destroy what has made America great. And we should not be undermining what makes America great. We should be exporting it in the way that Tom Paine talked about. Democratic internationalism. Let's send our people, let's send our businesses, let's send our political leaders, let's send our orators, let's send America all over the world to bring the reforms that will bring peace on earth. Because it's such a tiny, tiny portion of the world that's engaged with the Islamic State, that terrorist death cult, and Al-Qaeda. Tiny, tiny numbers of people. We got to cut them off financially, cut them off politically, cut them off intellectually, morally, ideologically, and militarily, and be done with it so we can get on to the important projects of our time, which are dealing with global warming. We didn't even get to talk about climate change. 2015, the hottest year on record. After 2014, the hottest year on record. After 2013, and so on, for the last 14 years. And the Republicans, if you watch their debates, I don't know if you're addicted to them the way I am. It's like electoral pornography to me, you know? I watch all of them. They will not mention the words climate change. And if you ask them about it, their answer is, I don't know. I'm not a scientist. As if that weren't perfectly clear to the viewing audience, right? None of these people are scientists. If you're not a scientist, your job is to listen to the scientists. It's like you go to the doctor, and they say, you're very sick. You need to get on medicine. You need surgery immediately. And you come home, and your wife says, are you sick? And you say, I don't know. I'm not a doctor. You just went to the doctor, right? So we have got to deal with climate change. I'm the only candidate, I think, in this race, unless Joel may have joined me. I don't know the others. I'm saying I'm not taking any money from big oil, big gas, big coal. We need to break from the carbon industries, break from the carbon barons in order to get to a carbon tax and invest in the renewable energy future that will save humanity. For our children and our grandchildren. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Jamie, for that shout out. I was going to say climate change, in fact, is happening inside of Iran. You know the desertification that's happening there. And it's real, and it does have an impact on real people's lives. And I have to say, it is such a breath of fresh air, to be amongst candidates who actually are looking for solutions that don't just kill people and rip up international agreements. Think about this. Every presidential candidate right now on the Republican side has sworn that they will rip up the Iran nuclear agreement. Great. What will that leave us with? This choice again. Let Iran get the bomb or start a war, which of course are both horrendous choices, and we can't go down that path. And it's going to take constant vigilance. there are some things that we can do as well to make sure that we don't even get close to that, not just about winning elections here at home, but in terms of the policy that this administration in its last year can execute and that members of Congress can call for. I want to point that out because when I was an activist promoting diplomacy with Iran as far back as 8 years ago, spending 6 years actively advocating for it, I understand that it takes a lot of pressure and a lot of work. It's not just how should I vote kind of a question that a member should be asking. The members should be asking, how can I build the political environment to actually create peace and diplomacy? So for 6 years, that's what I was doing with the support of many in this room. And there are things that we can see members of Congress doing right now in the administration right now. I'll put it in two buckets. The first is on human rights. Human rights matters. Human rights matters, period. It matters for our quality as people. It matters strategically. It matters to ensuring that the people inside Iran are both living a better life and that the government is feeling the pressure. Many times throughout the last 7 or 8 years, I witnessed, when I was running the campaign to promote diplomacy with Iran at Plowshares Fund, I witnessed debates. My friend Marad Gorban has seen this in spades. Debates between those who said, well, we want human rights and this nuclear deal is just going to damage the Iranian people. And then people who want a nuclear deal say, well, we want a nuclear deal, we don't want a war with Iran, but let's you know, put human rights to the side. False choice. False choice. Some of the greatest advocates for the Iran deal were the human rights activists and the people inside of Iran who understand very well that a better relationship with the West, with the United States, will over time make their country healthier and safer for them. Iranians are smart. You know what's going on. You don't want to see your home country fall apart. Iran can't turn into Syria. Iran can't turn into Iraq. It doesn't have to. But this will take time and patience and partnership with those on the outside. And there's a way we can help do that. As the U.S. government, we could put an intersection in Tehran tomorrow. We should. It's long overdue. It's way long overdue. I was at the State Department when we announced that we were going to open relations with Havana in Cuba. Now the president just visited there. It can be done, and it should be done. I'm not saying full diplomatic relations right now because I think that you need to hold that out as a tool to ensure, as leverage, that you're moving the government in the right direction. But an intersection, long overdue. That's a direct American presence.
Oh, okay.
Not the Swiss, a direct American presence. And you know, this is why I'm very proud to have the support of people like Tom Pickering, who's endorsed me, former Undersecretary of State, a leader on this issue. Many former senior ambassadors are supporting me in my campaign. People in the progressive national security community are supporting me because they understand I take this stuff seriously, and we play to win, and we understand that the human quality is the key. The intersection, it has to happen, and human rights, that has to happen, and we always have to be watching our backside to make sure that people do not sneak in legislation like the ending of the visa waiver to undermine the diplomatic achievement that we should all be very proud of. Thank you.
Thank you for the candidates for attending.
We're going to take one question from the public.
Well, thanks everyone.
What do you want to do for you?